The story is told, many years before Earthman ventured into space, a doomed planet of superhuman beings existed in another galaxy billions of miles away. The planet was called Krypton. The ill-fated planet was the home of a civilization far advanced in science and technology to that of our own. The leaders of Krypton felt assured that their planet was safe beyond destruction. And so when Krypton's leading scientist, Jor-El, pleaded for the safety of his people, his plea fell on deaf ears. And ultimately, the planet was lost to the ages. But as it marked the end of Krypton, it signified the beginning of a legend, the legend of Superman, a superhero, a superstar. It wasn't until 1938 that Superman first saw the light of day. And for the mere sum of 10 cents and a little help from your imagination, you could transpose yourself into the world of the mighty visitor from another planet who could leap 1/8 of a mile, hurdle a 20-story building, raise tremendous weights, run faster than an express train. Wait a minute. It doesn't say one word here about his flying.
Here, let me see that.
Say, aren't you,
No, but he is.
I used to be, but I'm not anymore.
Oh, and I have a sneaking suspicion that Lois Lane and Jimmy Olsen of the Daily Planet are putting me on.
That's a trick we used to play on Clark Kent.
Then I feel honored. Ladies and gentlemen, Noel Neal and Jack Larson. I don't really think they need any introduction.
It's been a long time since I've held one of these comic books in my hand. Do you know that if you had a copy of one of these today, it'd be worth $4,000?
That is, if you could find one. And these are number 2 and 3.
Well, I must remind you that these are collector's items and that they're on loan to us and not available at your local newsstand.
I brought in a first issue of Superman's pal Jimmy Olsen comic books. This came out right after the television show went on the air.
And after the character that you were playing started to become very popular.
Right afterwards, they brought out that, and it became really their most popular comic book for many, many years.
Did the same people draw all three cartoons?
Well, they had a kind of assembly line. I actually saw that. I used to go back to New York because I'd worked there as an actor when I still acted in live television, and I'd always call on the National Comics people. And they had an assembly line of cartoonists at that time. Actually, the man that had created Superman, Joe Shuster, of Siegel and Shuster, mm-hmm. The two together, he was working on the line at that time. I was once shown him. He'd needed a job, and he'd lost rights to Superman early on, and by various means, he'd managed to get just a regular job from them. And he was just sitting there drawing, and they'd pass one on to the other.
We all know the tremendous reincarnation we're having with Superman today. What has this done to your lives? It's been quite a few years since you were involved in the making of the television show Superman. And now the popularity of the characters itself has come back into everybody's faces. Has it changed you, or has it brought back memories? What has it meant to you both?
Who's first?
Either
first.
Or.
Either or, okay.
Well, I've been very fortunately asked to do college shows, lecture type thing. So I've had many fun times with the students for the last 4 or 5 years.
Can you talk about the making of the original
Superman show, and I have scripts and get the kids up to play the parts. And questions and answers, they always want to know where Jimmy is and what he's doing.
And what is Jimmy, and what has he been doing?
Well, Jimmy quit acting in 1960, and I quit, and I'd gotten very typed, of course. I'd regarded myself as a very serious actor. Had been on the contract to Warner Brothers, had done a number of movies and live television things, but the Superman show eclipsed everything. I thought only for a while. I now know permanently, no matter, I'm a writer, if I would get the Nobel Prize at the end of my life, whatever my obituary would say, best remembered is
Jimmy Olsen.
And so
I used to feel that way about my teeth before I got my first cabinet.
And so I've come to accept that. For years I fought it. I'd had a double life when I was on Superman. I used to go off and work as a writer in New York. I was one of the original off-Broadway playwrights.
I think one thing that's kind of important and shows the tremendous difference in the 20 years since Superman started out on television, as opposed to what some of the series are today, there were tremendous restrictions placed on you as actor and actress, as far as allowing you, you weren't able to do other shows. You were under a very difficult kind of contract that no longer exists today.
Yes.
And I think the actor today has an opportunity when the show is not actually shooting to go out and do other things.
Yes.
You had such a restriction on you that you became so definitely identified with the characters on the Superman show. That made getting other employment a little difficult, didn't it?
Eventually, it made it pretty impossible. I was totally typed by the time the show, for years I fought it, but then I was typed, and I really tried. Noel, I know, stayed in Los Angeles, but I tried everything.
Did you find it difficult too, Lois?
Well, yes, I believe we were all pretty well typed, but I, as I say, luckily got into the college thing, which sort of smoothed the path a little bit. I took advantage of being Lois Lane, frankly. Thought I might as well go with it.
And, of course, the same effect happened to George Reeves as far as his acting career.
Yes,
a lot of people don't realize that he was a very fine and respected actor here in the community, in Hollywood, before he got the Superman series.
George was a marvelous actor. He'd studied at the Royal Academy. He'd co-starred in films with Claudette Colbert, Paulette Goddard, Meryl Oberon, and he was just a guy. He was away in the service, Second World War, all during the war. He didn't really reestablish himself when he came out, and when he did do a film, which he had done just before Superman went on the air, From Here to Eternity, he was so typed and recognizable, they had to cut him out of the film, and that was that. A minute ago, Tom, you mentioned the opening of that original Action Comics and said that the first few words sounded rather strange. I think that we've become so accustomed to thinking of Superman flying that many people forget that he didn't learn to fly right away.
Actually, Siegel and Shuster drew their Man of Steel to leap about an eighth of a mile, but the form looked as though Superman was indeed in flight.
Hurdle a tall building?
In a single bound. But that came later. And if you really listen carefully to the opening of our TV show, it never really describes Superman as flying. It just says, it's a bird, it's a plane. No.
No, it's another Thol Simonson special effect. And Thol will be joining us in just a little bit to actually show us some of Superman's secret power.
Like flying through the air. Let me tell you a story about an early episode of the TV series. We were shooting one called The Ghost Wolf in 1951 at the old RKO Pathé Studios.
That was the first year, wasn't it?
The very first year of the show. And we had very lavish sets because Howard Hughes owned the studio at that time, and he'd done Androcles and the Lion. There was a huge forest set. Jimmy was trapped somewhere in the forest. It was on fire, and they flew George in. They were at that time attempting to fly him on wires. This was the end of that, because they strung up this wire from the top of the sound station. George came down. There were flames. I was trapped, and the wire broke.
Oh, boy.
And George fell on his super behind and let loose super utterances that the children of America would never be permitted to hear.
And it probably put out the fire, too.
No. The fire raged, I remember. Everybody was so shocked. Looking at, there he is on the ground. And George was wiping himself off and saying, that's enough of that. And I remember him saying that Peter Pan flies, but Superman doesn't fly. And that way. He was very acrobatic, you know, and was able to do his all of his own stunts. He'd do wonderful curl-unders over camera. He'd leap over camera with a diving board in the floor that Cy Simonson arranged for him. But after that, he would never fly on a wire.
Tell me something. Out of 104 shows, about how many times do you think you were rescued?
Oh, 104.
More.
Sometimes twice in one episode.
Twice in the show. It depended how up the creek they were.
You mentioned earlier that George did a lot of his own stunts aside from the apparatus. He did all. Did you guys do your own stunts too?
Sure. We flew in one show and the last show, as a matter of fact.
I did all my own stunts. As a matter of fact, I was saying, I trusted Cy. You call him Thor Simonson. I know him as Cy Simonson. I trusted Cy Simonson. so much with special effects that I later got into very bad habits. I'd do anything he set up for me to do. I mean, explosives would go off in my face, gases would go, fire hydrants would shoot, anything would happen.
And you were assured by him that it would be just...
I have hung from buildings with villains pounding on my hands, and I've done everything. It alleviates the boredom, you know, to do your own stunts. But later, when I was doing other things, and I'd worked with other stuntmen or special effects men, I realized that I trusted Cy so much, I'd just do anything, and it was a mistake because the things didn't go right as they did with Cy.
I think perhaps this might be a good place for us to introduce our next special guest, Mr. Thole Simonson, the gentleman without whom Superman might never have been able to fly. Thole, everybody's calling you by your nickname, Cy. Can I call you Cy? It'd
be my pleasure.
Now, what is this contraption, this mask you've been holding in your hand? Would you tell us a little bit about it?
This is from a show, Man in the Lead Mask, that George did he never saw. We came out on the set. Well, he put it on, he had it on, went through two or three scenes, and he developed claustrophobia. In the process of ripping it off of his head in a hurry, he took half his nose with it.
And the skin from it.
Quite, and he refused to put it back on. So when all this happened, the front office was down, and the person of the producer, Mr. Whitney Ellsworth, and he wanted to know what happened. In the 5 years that we did the show, this was the only hang-up that I'd experienced, and I didn't know how to cope with it, frankly, and I managed to go over in the corner and cut the back out and put it on and off my head real fast. George happened to notice, and he came over and said, well, okay, if you can do it that easy, I'll take a crack at it again.
Well, what did you do? Just split the
took all the heavy part out and put tape over it so that he could kind of push it back so it wouldn't catch on his nose when he put it on.
And then he could get it off much easier. And he finally condescended to do it.
He did, graciously, and fortunately we were able to go on, and that was the end of that. But that was a hang-up for me, and the only one that had nothing of any consequence, but time was important, as you well know.
Right.
These are examples of how Superman would go out the window. This is George Fisher, the stuntman, giving us these illustrations.
The only thing that's different here, and we didn't have the room to be able to allow him to do the nip and tuck that George used to do. Most of his were done with a tuck and roll. He would get more height, and he could point his toes a little better. But we're limited here with room.
Now, was George possessed with natural athletic ability?
Those things that he did like this, he got so he could do it as well or better than anybody I've ever seen try it. He was very good at any athletic thing, but in these particular things that he had so much practice, he was excellent.
All right, Sinister Sam, the jig's up. I'm taking you in.
Go as high as you can, go out as far as you can.
Your job was to design these
stunts. My job was primarily, all I did was take care of the physical things that went with getting him in and out. Right. Naturally, you know better than I do, but the idea is to look like you're leaving back here and...
Yeah, that's so, what I'm trying to get for you.
Here's we're going to get this perpendicular flying shot, and we would, instead of running the bar through the screen, we'll run it parallel. We'll superimpose the background on here afterwards so that you'll look like you're over the city.
Now, your big contribution, though, to Superman, when you came in after the first 26 shows, George had that accident where he fell from the wire, and he swore, and I'm using that literally, that he would never fly with a wire again, and you were asked to come up with a device that would make it visually feasible for him to fly, and this is the device you came up with. Would you like to explain it? I know that there's a hydraulic system involved, which is not here in this illustration.
Well, primarily what we had was some manner that he was secure. We had him attached to a glass cloth pan that went under the uniform. that extended through a backing that was 30 foot in the air, and he would be in the middle of that, and it would be horizontal or vertical, and we could roll him in either direction. We could even spin him, and it was all done hydraulically with the valves right down next to the camera where you could see what you were doing. Then the background was superimposed. The fan to get the action of the cape, and as you fellas turn a little and move a little, you will get the action. You have to point the toes and cover the bar. And I think this will do it when the cape is flying, etc. This is about the way it'll feel. Are you comfortable?
I'm comfortable.
Great. I think we can let him down, fellas, and we'll get his trunks off and get ready to do it the way we're going to have to end up. Real fine. All right, fine. I think you've got it right there. Up a little with your hands, George. Make a little turn here, fellas, around that building. Now back. Now back down. Okay, now relax and let the arms go down a little and get the strain off them. Now when we did, there you go, around the point. Turn him a little here now. The other way, we're turning him wrong. There he goes, now around the point. Take him the other way. All right, okay. All right, back we go. That's great. That's far enough. Now ease him back, straighten him out. Perfect. George, I think the director said the action would be right in here.
All right.
So we've made the cut here. We go up to the header here. Watch the plate. We're down clean to the bottom.
Okay.
And you come in. We don't have a pad, so be careful. Well, I'll put this back a little.
That's great.
Come around back. I'll show you the rest of it here. There's this isn't as easy as the last one. This here is a little tougher. It isn't the brick deal. And you can see we're up high enough for you.
Yeah.
But watch this down here, whatever you do, yeah.
Okay.
I think we're ready.
All right, I'll give it a try. Coming through. Oh, if I'd have known there was a door there, I'd have used it.
Thank you, George Fisher. Say, Cy, do you think that you could give me some of that super strength, huh? You know, for the kids and everything?
Sure, Tom. George wouldn't mind.
Let's see. Oh, I feel like a new man.
I got it.
Eat your heart out, Fonzie.
Very good.
Say, listen, you think I could try walking through a wall?
Why not?
Huh?
Why not?
Jack, when did the show go to color?
At the end of 1954, I believe, we shot the first color shows.
Now, you might be interested to know that this is the only color Superman costume in existence, and it belongs to Cal State Fullerton. I don't know who the moth holes belong to, but I guess time has kind of chewed it up a little bit.
I was wondering, too. Noel and I saw it earlier, and I last remember seeing it on George, and I saw those moth holes in it.
Speaking of George and all of you, we have some pictures that were taken during the shooting of Superman. And let's take a look here at the screen and we can comment on them. Now here looks like George is somewhere in the jungle.
Well, I remember that show, and it was a voodoo doctor, and I remember Jimmy was manacled in paper chains and hypnotized, and later ended up in a squeezing room that George flew apart.
Handsome.
What kind of a man was George Reeves?
Who's first?
Mm, beautiful man. Such a gentleman, but a great sense of humor.
He was a wonderful guy, and he was a love to work with. He always called himself Honest George, the people's friend. And if I judged him correctly, I think he gave away more money to out-of-work people, actors and stuff, than he ever earned playing mm-hmm. Superman. He was a touch.
And who is this?
It's John, John Hamilton, my
That's
senator.
Chief.
Chief. If I said chief to him now and I didn't hear, don't call me chief, Matt.
I wouldn't know his name, but the face I had seen in many, many movies. Now, there's another face
Jack.
In the past.
Oh, look.
And I would have said that
That's your son,
exist.
Jack?
That's my son. That's him. I would have said it didn't exist because I swore there wasn't a picture of me in a bow tie.
Now, there you are. See all of you, George and...
Pearson Fison.
That's the crew. There we are. Bob Shane, John Hamilton.
Robert Shane.
The beautiful Noel Neal, George Reeves. And that's Sam.
His dog.
You know, I can tell from these pictures that he must have had a wonderful sense of humor. He has a gleam in his eye.
Yes, he did.
This one here is the one we had the trouble with. He had a drop so far onto the tail that to get out of the shot that it was quite a feat.
Gee, he was good. And that's... appeared as my favorite picture of all. I never knew it existed, and somebody showed it to me one day back east. It's George had come through a wall, was obviously saying something, make me laugh. I'm leaning on his shoulder laughing, and wonderful
Henry West.
Henry. We used to rush in to brush George off.
Yeah. Now, there's the rifle you just bent. There's the barrel.
Jeff Corey, very fine actor.
Very fine actor.
Just kind of getting going then, good.
Yeah. And there we are.
There are the three stars wondering if their option is going to be renewed.
And then it was. Always. Luckily.
And so Superman lives on. In television as George Reeves. In the hearts of the millions who've shared his adventures. And I'm certain he will continue to live on in television seasons yet to come. To be enjoyed by millions more. And thank you, Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster. Thank you, Action Comics. Thank you, Warner Communications, Whitney Ellsworth, the crew of Superman. Thank you, Thol Simonson, for joining us and for helping Superman all these years. And George Fisher. Thank you, Noel and Jack. And most of all, thank you, George Reeves, because you gave us something very special. You gave Superman life. And thank you for watching.